Hi everybody, my name is Haley LaPointe. I'm a meteorologist at WMUR-TV. We're based in Manchester, New Hampshire. Today I'm going to talk to you about weather instruments and also about forecasting the weather. Of course, weather instruments are really important for meteorologists to be able to use to figure out what's happening right now with the weather, and it helps us look at the future too. And that's where the forecasting part comes in. We are making forecasts for our TV audience that goes for the next 24 hours all the way to the next 7 days, and sometimes we even do seasonal forecasts too. So today we'll take a look at the weather instruments and weather forecasting. All right, so let's get started here. First off, who are meteorologists? Well, meteorologists are people who study the weather. And it's not just TV meteorologists. There are meteorologists that do all sorts of different jobs in weather. That may be jobs where they're chasing tornadoes and trying to obtain data about tornado damage, or maybe they're flying in planes that go into hurricanes to obtain data to get better forecasts for hurricanes. There's lots of different jobs that meteorologists have in what we call the private sector, or even with the government, that doesn't include anything with TV or with broadcasting. But that's what my job entails, working on TV. I spend a couple hours a day where I will look at current weather and how the weather is evolving. I use different what we call weather models to figure out what's going to happen with storms as they move across the United States and across the globe, to then be able to provide a forecast for people. And of course, to prepare people for bad weather. If there's the possibility of tornadoes, you know, what should people be doing? Or if there's going to be a snowstorm, what is the time frame that will be impacting people and plow drivers? So my job is important because it's not just telling people whether or not it's going to rain today, but it can sometimes be life or death if we're talking about severe weather and extreme weather. So meteorologists study the weather, but they do lots of different jobs outside of television. So how does somebody become a meteorologist? Well, it's really important to have a strong interest in weather. I always joke with a lot of my colleagues that we are weather geeks, and it's true. We are, me and fellow meteorologists, a lot of us have known since we were children that we wanted to be meteorologists, and that is absolutely the case for me. In fact, this picture here of a tornado sums it up really well for me. It was in kindergarten, actually, for me, when I went to my school library. I grew up in northern Massachusetts in Topsfield, Mass. And I remember going to my library and seeing books on display about tornadoes. I remember running over and grabbing them and wanting to read more about tornadoes and figure out why they happen and how they form. So for me, that's what inspired me to become a meteorologist. So certainly having a strong interest in weather is really good. It's also important to have solid math and science skills. So, you know, certainly in my day-to-day life as a broadcaster, I'm not using high-end and, you know, extensive calculus, but certainly when I was in college, I had to take all levels of calculus and physics-based calculus. So there is a lot of math and science involved in the study of meteorology. So I always recommend for middle and high schoolers to make sure that you're taking lots of science and math all throughout those years, and to have a really solid foundation in it. Then from there, I went on to college. I studied in Vermont at Linden State College. I earned a four-year bachelor's of science in meteorology there. And then I went on to start working in television, and I've been working in TV now for about 10 years. So what we're gonna do now is we're gonna play like a little game here. And we're going to talk about weather instruments and weather tools. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you a photo of a weather instrument, and you are going to then take a look and figure out what it is. Now, typically when I'm doing this in a classroom, I'd have people shout out what the answer is, but I'll give you a second to think about it, and then we will answer it. And what's kind of cool is what I'll do is I'll show you some data as to what these devices are and where I get a lot of this data on the internet, because that's where I actually do most of my forecasting, right on the internet, and it's readily available to the public even. So here's the first one. Do you know what this is? What is this guy holding? It looks like he's out on a ship deck. Well, he is holding an anemometer. So on the top there, if you can see my little cursor, those are cups. And what happens is the wind gets caught in those cups and it spins the cups around. And then there's a little computer in this handheld device that converts how many times those cups spin around into miles per hour or meters per second. So that way he knows how fast the wind speed is on the top of that ship. There is also a little flag here, and that's telling him the wind direction. Okay, so what do I have to show wind? Well, let me take a look at that. I'll bring up one of the websites that I like to use, and what I look at is surface data. Oh no, there's no data available. That's a problem. So, on the fly here, I'll bring up WMUR.com/weather, and we'll look right here, and it looks like for the wind, we're out of the west at about 5 miles per hour. So I do typically like to use a different website to look at winds, but we'll just say for now, WMUR.com/weather. You can even put in your zip code and find the wind right there. Okay, so now the next thing is this. What is this tool? Well, I think most people know this one. It's a thermometer, right? And this tool tells us the temperature of the air, wherever that thermometer is. So it could be inside, or if the thermometer is outside, it can tell you the temperature outside. Now, here's a couple bonus questions. You see how it says F and C on it? Those are two units of measure. The F stands for Fahrenheit, and that's how we in the United States measure our temperature. It's the unit of measurement. Whereas across the rest of the United States, we use Celsius. So in Fahrenheit, do you know what the temperature of freezing is? It's 32 degrees Fahrenheit. Now, do you happen to know what it is in Celsius? 0. 0 degrees Celsius. Now, for temperature, I use a different website too, but again, for our purposes today, there's WMUR.com and you can see that it says 51 degrees currently. All right, next up, tools that meteorologists use. What could this be? This is a rain gauge, and this is a tool that we use to look at how much rain has fallen. So people have these out maybe in their backyard, and the rain will fall into this cylinder, and there's a little ruler printed on the side, and you can see as the water fills up, you can then tell just how much rain in inches has fallen. Okay, how about this? Well, this is a weather satellite. Yes, and it is used to take pictures of the Earth's surface. So, meteorologists use satellites a lot. I use it many, many times during my shift when I'm working in the studio, not only to forecast, but I like to look at it just as a way to figure out what's happening with the weather. So the satellite is constantly taking pictures of the Earth. So the United States launched rockets with this satellite, millions of dollars worth of satellite up there over us. And the United States has at least two weather satellites. We have GOES 16 East, which is the one primarily over the eastern half of the United States, and then we have GOES West, and that's primarily on the western side of the United States. And they're docked over the same area, so they are programmed to move at the same rate as the Earth spins. So that way we always have the same view of the Earth. So why don't we take a look at a view from the satellite? So this is a view live as I'm recording this, and what you're looking at here, the white, the stuff that's moving that's white, that's clouds. So the satellite is using visible light. I'm looking at a visible satellite here. It's using the visible light, sunlight, to show the clouds moving. So something else that's interesting to note is we can also see where it's clear, we can see the ground. And in the wintertime, we can see what's on the ground, Right now, we can see a little bit of snow and ice. In northern New Hampshire, you can make out the white mountains there. And certainly up in Quebec, there's some white here. That's snow and ice on ground and on lakes. But the white that's moving, this big area here, that is all cloud cover. So with a satellite, we can only see clouds. We can't see precipitation, can't see the rain, snow, sleet, hail. We use a different tool for that, and we're going to talk about that in a second here. What is this? This is a barometer. Looks like a weather compass, doesn't it? It's a barometer and it measures air pressure. Now, air pressure is very important for meteorologists. It tells us a lot. When you watch meteorologists on TV, have you ever noticed they talk about a big L, big red L on the map, and they say low pressure, or there's a big blue H indicating high pressure? Well, both of those different pressure centers mean big differences in the weather. So when there's high pressure over us, that means that the air is being suppressed down. And that means you can't get clouds to grow generally. So when there's high pressure, that means that we generally have good weather. So sunshine, clear skies. But when you have low pressure, that's when there are storms moving through. So, an example of a low pressure system would be a hurricane or a nor'easter or even just a run-of-the-mill snowstorm that comes through. Those are low pressure systems. And the barometer, the needle there moves based on what the air pressure reading is. What could this be? Well, this is a radar. So, we talked a little bit about this earlier. This is a Doppler radar. They're on the ground. And there's a very strong beam of radiation that shoots out of that ball there. And it shoots up to 300 miles up into the sky. And then it does a full 360 scan of the sky. And it's looking for precipitation. So once that beam runs into, say, rain, and then sends a signal back to the Doppler radar, and we can then tell that it's rain, or if it's snow, or sleet, or any other type of precipitation. So, in the United States, there are over 200 radars. So, all of those three-letter codes there, that's where there are radars in the United States. So, the one that covers New Hampshire is in Gray, Maine. Oh no, and they're down right now. Huh. Well, that's not good. Yep. Of course, it's not working. So we use radars to look at precipitation. So I'm gonna go back to my handy WMUR here, and we do have a radar on our site here that allows you to see what's happening. So I'll zoom out, and there's the radar. I'll put it in motion. So green on the radar indicates rain. Yellow indicates heavy rain, and the oranges and reds also indicate rain. You see up, let me see if I can drag this down. You see up here, this is our legend for the map. And you see that rain is this green color, and heavy rain is in like the pinks here. And then this pink is mixed, so sleet, freezing rain, and then blue is snow. And you can see there is some snow up across Michigan and Wisconsin. So the radar is really important for meteorologists to be able to utilize. Okay, what is this? It is a weather vane or a wind vane, and it shows us the direction that the wind is blowing. Sometimes we'll see these on barns, and what these do is they spin and they show you the direction that the wind is coming from. All right, what is this? Well, this is a weather balloon. And most importantly, what's in this lady's hand here, this box, is called a radiozonde. And inside that radiozonde is pretty much all the instruments we've talked about today, except for, of course, the radar and the satellite. So it's got a thermometer, a barometer, it's got an anemometer, it has tools to measure humidity and dew point. And what happens is they launch these balloons, the National Weather Service does. They launch these balloons every twice a day, actually, and they go up into the atmosphere, and all along the way, that box is collecting data because You have to realize this. The weather is not just the same where you're standing versus up in the clouds. The temperature changes, the air pressure changes. So it's really helpful for meteorologists to know what's happening up in the upper part of the atmosphere. It helps us to forecast. So this balloon data is really important. All right. Now we're going to segue into talking about forecasting the weather. And for me, it's a three-step process. If it's a quiet weather day, like if there's high pressure overhead and we have a lot of sun, it maybe takes me about an hour. If it's a more complex weather day where we have a nor'easter moving in or the threat of tornadoes and severe weather, then it can take me sometimes an hour and a half, 2 hours to really look at everything. So I'm going to give you a quick three-step process here as to how I make my forecast. So, step number one is what's happening right now? So, I literally will, I've got a window right here. I look out the window, I look up in the sky, I analyze the wind. Is it blowing the trees around out there? What type of clouds are out there right now? It's important to know what's happening right now before I can look at the future. I also do look at what we call climatology. So, I'll look at what the average high and average low should be for today. That gives me kind of a baseline as to where the temperatures should be. Then I'll utilize, a satellite here to look at what could be happening upstream, off toward the west. I'll look at the radar here and look at where this rain and this snow is headed. Is it going off toward the west? Is it coming to the east toward us? So I utilize those different tools to look at what's happening right now, or maybe in the just recent past, so in the last couple of hours. Then step two, I analyze model data. So you might be asking, well, what is a model? Well, a model is actually a big, long math equation. I know you're like, what? Don't want to hear about that. Well, it's a math equation that's solved by a big computer. And the math equation, the variables in the equation are all different weather variables. So it might be temperature, it might be dew point, it might be barometric pressure. And we have maybe five or six different models that at least I look at on a daily basis, and each model has a different math equation. So each of the models sometimes have different forecasts. So let me show you an example of one of these models. So I know there's a lot on this map to look at, but I'll show you. This is New Hampshire right here, right there. And the black solid lines are what we call isotherms, sorry, isobars. And that is lines of constant pressure. So remember, we were talking about high and low pressure? Then the blue and the red dashed lines, those are isotherms, lines of constant temperature. So when I'm forecasting here, the green is actually just precipitation. It's not necessarily rain or snow. I have to look at the isotherms on there to figure out what's happening. But I'll go along and I'll kind of see what happens over time. You see this big blue H here? Remember what that stands for? High pressure. So that means we have clear skies overhead. And then I watch to see, oh, okay, well, there's a little low pressure system, that red L right there. That's going to try to move by. And I'll compare and I'll contrast my different models. I'll see if it's bringing in that little low pressure, or if that low pressure is more to the south on one of the other models. So I'll figure out which model I'm favoring and which one is working better. But not any one model is perfect. And this is why our forecasts still aren't perfect. We will get the forecast wrong sometimes. That definitely happens because these computer models are not perfect and they're always changing and evolving. What's kind of cool on the WMUR site is you can look at FutureCast. It's one of the models that we use. And watch, this kind of shows us how that rain moves as it gets closer and closer to us. Now, as a meteorologist, I have to look and see if I agree with that movement based on the winds and the barometric pressure. So, step three is using my meteorological knowledge, pattern recognition, and experience to make the final call on the forecast. So that's where I'm kind of just thinking about, all right, what am I going to do for the high or the low? I know that Concord is usually a little bit colder each night than Manchester, so I make kind of those mental notes and make decisions on the forecast that way. This is an example of like what our 7-day forecast looks like. So I make that forecast. I'll change the sun and the rain and the numbers there. All right. I want to thank you all so much for watching and for getting more information about weather instruments and forecasting. If you have questions, I would love to answer them. You can email me there, or you can go on Twitter or Facebook and submit your questions. Thanks for watching.